Hello, this is Rabbi David Idenson, author of the book Secret of the Scale on Marriage and Human Relations. Our website is secretscale.com. Today I've been asked to speak about WikiLeaks. What is my opinion about this? A person maintains a website that reveals secrets of the most sensitive nature, secrets that, when revealed, can have disastrous consequences, even threats to people's life. What do I think about this? First of all, I want to thank very much the person who asked me, one of the subscribers, one of the people that are interested in our videos. I'm very happy that a person would want to hear what I have to say. So I was thinking what to say, and here we like to go beyond just the reported goings-on of the world. We like to go into a depth analysis of what something is, get a different perspective, and the idea here of a person going and taking state secrets or other type of secrets and just loading them on for the whole world to see, where they can cause great problems and violation of privacy and violation of even people's safety. We have to understand this is not an isolated incident in our present culture and mindset. Hackers are people for many years have devoted themselves to destroying people's websites, to breaking into people's websites, to creating viruses that destroy people's businesses, and to steal information that can ruin people's financial security, and indeed rob people of the happiness that they deserve in life. So talking about WikiLeaks is really talking about a phenomena that includes hackers. And we have to understand, what does a hacker want? What does WikiLeaks want? Doesn't WikiLeaks know when they give out information about what people in Afghanistan worked on behalf of the United States, that they were endangering their lives? Yes, he knew it. He's not stupid. He's near genius. He knew that it would endanger people's lives. He did it anyway. When a hacker goes in and ruins someone's financial security or damages their business or makes viruses that can destroy people's computers and much work which they have done, why did they do it? They are doing vicious things and they're proud of it. Hackers have conventions. They have conventions. They come together. It's like a society. No one is ashamed to say I'm a hacker. They're proud of it. These hackers and the WikiLeaks people have no respect for anybody else's interests, financial, even their lives. They want to destroy. Some say, well, we want to destroy the WikiLeaks, say we have to become involved in transparency, so that's a fig leaf. But the other ones say, no, I'm just here to smash. She says, why are you ruining people's computers and damaging their businesses and ruining their fiscal security, giving out their information? No, one of the hackers said, why is it they didn't make better protection? We want to promote security. In other words, you want to destroy people to promote security. And someone said that's like going down the street and smashing windows because the people didn't protect the windows. And that's exactly what's happening. And yet this is catching on with a lot of bright, intelligent people that they devote their lives, at least many hours of their lives, to being hackers, destroyers, and create chaos. In my family, I don't think it's possible anyone would want to be a hacker. I don't think any of my children or grandchildren or great-grandchildren, whatever, would ever want to be a hacker, would ever want to spend hours learning how to hurt people. So why is it that so many other people are devoting their lives to hurting people? Why? Why are there hackers and why are there people that just publish things of the most important sensitivity, even though it endangers people's lives? And I was thinking about this. What's the answer to this question? Why is it that my children or progeny wouldn't become hackers and so many other people's children are hackers? We have emphasized in our videos that there are two worlds in the torn country of America and the torn societies of the world. Family people and non-family people. That non-family people doesn't mean they don't have a family. There's a biological parent and a biological parents, but there's something missing in the nurture of the child. What's the difference? There was an article in the paper now about children going to college, and it used to be some people had problems. They would drop into the therapist to get some help, but today it's an avalanche. An avalanche of sick people. And we've spoken about this, and we've said that if you have a child growing up without nurture, that child is in danger. And in America, and in the rest of the world, we take this child who is probably lacking in nurture because there's so many divorces and so many broken marriages, and we take this child and send him to college, and he's taught, don't think the way you were raised to think the way your parents or religion raised you. You've got to think new radical thoughts. Be radical. And this poor kid, he's got... A person growing up in a world which I live in, he grows up and he does one thing. He's got a father and a mother that live only for him and her. My family and my mother, what do we want out of life? We want the children should be happy. Well, the child grows up and respects authority because the authority, the parental situation, is favorable, pleasant. A pleasure. You have people who live only to make you happy. Now let's go across the street to the secular family. There's a husband and a wife, and if they're lucky to stay together, or as long as they are together, and they've both been raised in Harvard and Yale to think of themselves, to think new thoughts, and they weren't taught there how to think only of the children. Believe me, that's something they'll never teach at Harvard and Yale. And this child grows up, he says, my father and mother, into themselves. They don't really live for me, for sure not. And there's a contention. My mother says, I want a life. I work all day. I come home. I got this screaming kid. And the kid senses the mother is not. Now, she has certain maternal instincts, but there's other things there also in conflict with the maternal instincts. The child picks up. Children are very able to appreciate exactly what people think of them. And the father, he comes home from a hard day, and he has his problems. Oh, this kid needs my time. I got no time. I got to make a telephone call. And the kid goes up like this, and he gets angry, and he gets bitter. He hates authority. And he goes up and becomes a hacker to kill and destroy the banks and the government and the businesses and the people that have money, break them, destroy them, ruin their lives. Because he grows up with that nurture, he becomes a hater. No, he doesn't hate minorities, you understand. Nobody in this day and age can hate a minority. But you can hate your parents. You can hate your teachers. You can hate the police and the government. And you can hate somebody in Afghanistan who happened to give some information about terrorists and killers. You can destroy their lives. Let's hate. Let's be hackers. WikiLeaks. We're talking about a world growing up without love and nurture. People who are raised without love and nurture grow up to hate. They're bitter. And they grow up at war with parents. Because with children, whether you're a teacher of children or you're a parent of children, you make it or you break it. If you make it, you plug in to the kid's process. And he's going, and he's growing, and he's developing. And he sees you're giving to him, and he wants to give back. That's the way it is in deeply religious and good families. But then there's out there, those who says, me, And the mother says, yeah, me, 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 me. And the kid says, what about me, me, me? And they're going to therapists and they're getting divorced and they're this and they're that. And they're spending all day with filth and television and internet. People like this, the children are robbed of a normal life they grew up in hate. So this is just one of the manifestations of the torn society of America and in the Western world and perhaps the whole world between the family culture and civilization and the non-family. And this is what WikiLeaks is, and this is what hackers are, an idealism of hate. Now, if you go back to the First World War, and before then, surely before then, there was a glorification of war. Patton once said, General Patton, the great American general who was raised in the First World War, he said the supreme human experience is war. And many people felt that way. It was especially prevalent in Germany and Austria. A very prominent doctor, when the First World War was beginning, he said, now I'm proud to be an Austrian because I'm going out to fight to make a war. That's the way people thought. War was a glorious thing. And today, of course, we shudder at war. I mean, war is so hideous. How can anybody glorify it? But there were times people glorified it. So people in the secular world, whether they lived 200 years ago, 100 years ago, and they glorified war, or they live today in the secular, non-God, non-religion, non-family world, and they glorify other things, it's all really about one thing. Only a person filled with hate can glorify war. And only a person filled with hate can glorify hacking and what goes on in WikiLeaks. Rabbi David Eidenson, author of the book Secret of the Scale of Managing Human Relations, our website is secretscale.com.